The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Greetings. Welcome this evening, and welcome to those who are with us online. The order of service is as printed with the following change. We will not stand for the reading, so where it says please stand, then just stay seated for the reading. And then also on the back, you will see the litany, the prayer litany. The soloist will sing, "Let us pray to the Lord," and then we sing, "Lord, have mercy." We sing the Lord's at the same time. The music for that is printed on page 249 in the front part of the hymnal. So when we get to that part of the service, I encourage you to open your hymnal to 249 for the prayers. We will have some announcements later on in the service. So we'll begin by standing. The Spirit and the Church cry out, "Come, Lord Jesus." All those who await his appearance pray, "Come, Lord Jesus." The whole creation pleads, "Come, Lord Jesus." Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who led your people Israel by a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. Enlighten our darkness by the light of your Christ. May his word be a lamp to our feet and a light to our path, for you are merciful and you love your whole creation, and we, your creatures, glorify you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. O Lord, I call upon you, hasten to me, give ear to my voice when I call to you. Set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth, keep a watch over the door of my lips. Do not let my heart incline to any evil, to busy myself with wicked deeds in company with men who work iniquity, and let me not eat of their delicacies. Let a righteous man strike me, it is a kindness. Let him rebuke me, it is oil for my head. Let my head not refuse it. Yet my prayer is continually against their evil deeds. When their judges are thrown over the cliff, when they shall hear my words, they are pleasant. As when one plows and breaks up the earth, so shall our bones be scattered at the mouth of Sheol. Eyes are toward you, O God. In you I seek refuge. Leave me not defenseless. Keep me from the trap they have laid for me and from the snares of evildoers. Let the wicked fall into their own nets while I pass safely by. Let us pray. Let the incense of our repentant prayer ascend before you, O Lord, and let your loving kindness descend on us, that with purified minds we may sing your praises with the church on earth and the whole heavenly host, and may glorify you forever.
Thank you. Old Testament reading for Advent is from 1 Kings chapter 19. Hezekiah received the letter from the hand of the messengers and read it. And Hezekiah went up to the house of the Lord and spread it before the Lord. And Hezekiah prayed before the Lord and said, O Lord, the God of Israel, enthroned above the cherubim, you are the God, you alone, of all the kingdoms of the earth. You have made heaven and earth. Incline your ear, O Lord, and hear. Open your eyes, O Lord, and see. And hear the words of Sennacherib, which he has sent to mock the living God. Truly, O Lord, the kings of Assyria have laid waste the nations and their lands and have cast their gods into the fire, for they were not gods, but the work of men's hands, wood and stone. Therefore they were destroyed. So now, O Lord our God, save us, please, from his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you, O Lord, are God alone. Then Isaiah, the son of Amos, sent to Hezekiah, saying, Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, Your prayer to me about Sennacherib, king of Assyria, I have heard. This is the word of the Lord. The gospel reading is from John chapter 9. As Jesus passed by, he saw a man blind from birth, and his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, It was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Having said these things, he spit on the ground and made mud with the saliva. Then he anointed the man's eyes with the mud and said to him, Go, wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. So he went and washed and came back seeing. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar were saying, Is this not the man who used to sit and beg? Some said, It is he. Others said, No, but he is like him. He kept saying, I am the man. So they said to him, Then how were your eyes opened? He answered, The man called Jesus made mud and anointed my eyes and said to me, Go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed and received my sight. They said to him, Where is he? He said, I do not know. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was the Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. So the Pharisees again asked him how he had received his sight. And he said to them, He put mud on my eyes, and I washed, and I see. Some of the Pharisees said, This man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But others said, How can a man who is a sinner do such signs? And there was a division among them. So they said again to the blind man, What do you say about him, since he has opened your eyes? He said, He is a prophet. The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, Is this your son who you say was born blind? Then how does he now see? His parents answered, We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but how he now sees we do not know, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he is of age. He will speak for himself. His parents said these things because they feared the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that if anyone should confess Jesus to be Christ, he was to be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, He is of age, ask him. So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind and said to him, Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner. He answered, Whether he is a sinner, I do not know. One thing I do know, though, was I was blind, now I see. They said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" And they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered, "Why, this is an amazing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes? We know that God does not listen to sinners, but if anyone is a worshiper in God and does his will, God listens to him. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." They answered him, "You were born in utter sin, and would you teach us?" And they cast him out. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and having found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir, that I may believe in him?" Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and it is he who is speaking to you." He said, "Lord, I believe," and he worshiped him. Jesus said, "For judgment I came into this world, that those who do not see may see, and those who see may become blind." Some of the Pharisees near him heard these things and said to him, "Are we also blind?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would have no guilt. But now that you say, 'We see,' your guilt remains." This is the word of the Lord.
O Lord, have mercy on us. Thanks be to God. In many and various ways, God spoke to his people of old by the prophets. But now in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In the hymn we just sang, "Lord, How Shall I Meet You?" Stanza 4 reads like this: "Love caused your incarnation, love brought you down to me. Your thirst for my salvation procured my liberty. O love beyond all telling that led you to embrace, in love all excelling, our lost and fallen race." That was also the song on the morning devotions this morning on our Facebook stream. If you weren't able to take a listen to that, you might want to, because that recording is excellent of that sentence, that stanza, which speaks of our Lord's thirst for our salvation that would lead him to embrace in love our lost and fallen race. In our reading in John chapter 9, we see the lost and we see the found. We see the blind and then we see the seeing. The man who had been born blind, that is what he's called multiple times. He is not given a name. That is an intentional device in the Gospel of John. The man who had been born blind, the man who had died, the man who could not walk. It is the way of describing a condition of a person which allows us then, the reader, to put ourselves into the reading. The man who had been born blind, that is, you and I have been born blind. This is our story as well. All of the gospel is for us as God's people. Now, this particular man who had been born blind ran into Jesus, and Jesus opened his eyes. It's almost humorous, the length of the story and the work of the Pharisees bouncing around to try to get answers. They refuse to see. And that is our theme this evening: the world refuses to see. 2 weeks ago, we talked about Andrew and Christ, who gives us eyes to see. And last week, we talked about Nathaniel and Philip, who called friends and family to see Jesus. They simply said, come and see. They invited. And here in this reading, it's quite clear that this man who had been born blind can now see. But the Pharisees refuse to see it. They will not be convinced. There are lots of people in our world who will not be convinced about Jesus, who will refuse to see him as the Savior, refuse to see him as God himself. We can take some insight from this story. The man does not attempt to prove to the Pharisees what Jesus did. In fact, he says things like, I don't know. Where is he? I don't know. How did he do it? Well, he put mud on my eyes and now I can see. I don't know. His parents say, we don't know. Go ask him yourself. Sometimes when we are attempting to tell somebody else about Jesus, we feel inadequate because we don't have all the answers. This man who had been born blind can be our patron saint of witnessing to others because he says, I don't know. It's okay to say, I don't know. Like last week, it was come and see. Because you see, it is not our task to prove God. It is not our task to make rational arguments for people that convince them into the kingdom. You do not have to have a PhD in missiology to tell someone of Jesus. And it's perfectly all right to say, I don't know. What he does say is, what I do know is, I could not see, and now I can, because of what he did. So this man witnesses to what had happened to him. That's a pretty good way to make a witness to our world. If you listen to Dave Ramsey, for instance, he says, well, I'm trying to get my parents to be wiser about their money. And he says, they don't want to hear from their child. But if you simply say, this is how we were struggling, and now this is how we are doing better, they tell of themselves. This man tells of himself. I was blind. He told me to go wash, and now I see. He simply states the facts of what happened to him. I went and washed and received my sight. Where is he now? I don't know. He put mud on my eyes, and I washed, and I see. For him, nothing deterred him. That was the fact. He was blind, and now he could see. It didn't matter whether the Pharisees came along and followed him or not. It didn't matter if his parents were happy about it. It didn't matter if he could convince others about what Jesus had done. The fact was the fact. Was that he could see. And then he says to them, do you also want to believe in him? And they get really angry. The world, others, our family members, our friends, those who do not know Jesus, or those who have had an experience that has driven them away from Jesus, they may become angry with our witnessing. And so we witness in love. We witness as gently but firmly as we can. This man here is unyielding. Even when he says, I don't know, he comes back around to what Jesus did. He doesn't forsake his testimony of who Jesus is. He simply makes the witness. And that is our task to the world. Tell of Jesus. Tell of who he is. Now, in John's gospel, everything is in a spiral and a Semitic way of writing. And so as the spiral goes around, it gets deeper and deeper all the way around through the gospel. And so here we start with his eyes, his seeing with his eyes. But at the end then, when Jesus comes back to him, he says, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" And he answered, "And who is he, sir, that I may believe in him?" And Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and it is he who is speaking to you." The term Son of Man is Jesus' most frequent self-referencing term. And to call himself the Son of Man is to call himself the Son, the servant of God, the one who would give his life for this man who had been born blind and for all of us who have been born blind to God. And so it isn't just simply that the man is happy that he got his sight back. He isn't just happy that Jesus is a really good ophthalmologist. He's happy that Jesus is the Son of Man. And he believes in him. That is the Messiah, the Savior of the world, the one who has come to save. Jesus said, "You have seen him. It is he who is speaking to you." And he said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. And so he got not only his sight, but he got the seeing of faith. For he leaves and goes home with salvation, with Jesus. This gospel ends, John chapter 20 ends with these words, "These things were written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." The whole purpose of John's gospel is to tell us of Jesus that we would see and believe. And he is not only our Savior, but the Savior of the whole world. And so like Philip and Nathaniel and Andrew, we simply say to the world, "Come and see." And like this man had been born blind, sometimes we say, "I don't know, but I know that I once was blind, and now I see." Jesus says in John's gospel, "When I am lifted up, I will draw all to me." The seeing of Jesus for the world is the seeing of Jesus lifted up on the cross. Because only the lifted up on the cross Jesus will save us. In his most holy name.
An angel went from God to a town called Nazareth to a woman whose name was Mary. The angel said to her, "Rejoice, O highly favored, for God is with you. You shall bear a child, and his name shall be Jesus, the chosen one of God Most High." And Mary said, "I am the servant of my God. I live to do your will." Thank you.
please stand to pray. The print music is printed on page 249 in the front part of the hymnal.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. For Matthew and Richard, for all pastors in Christ, especially Todd, Bill, and Richard, for all servants of the church and for all people, let us pray to the Lord. For Joseph, for all public servants, for the government and those who protect us, that they may be upheld and strengthened in every good deed, let us pray to the Lord. For those who work to bring peace, justice, health, and protection in this and every place, let us pray to the Lord. For those who bring offerings, those who do good works in this congregation, those who toil, those who sing, and all the people here present who await from the Lord great and abundant mercy, let us pray to the Lord. For favorable weather, for an abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord. Our deliverance from all affliction, wrath, danger, and need, let us pray to the Lord. For all those in need and asking for our prayers, let us pray to the Lord. For the faithful who have gone before us and are with Christ, let us give thanks to the Lord. Save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves, one another, and our whole life to Christ our Lord.
O God, from whom come all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works, give to us, your servants, that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments, and also that we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may live in peace and quietness through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Taught by our Lord and trusting his promises, we are bold to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Almighty and Merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you. Amen. Thank you. greet one another with the peace of the Lord.